Thank you, Madam Chair. Today, the Health Subcommittee will address the leading cause of preventable death worldwide, and that's tobacco, as well as the public health crisis of maternal mortality and morbidity. The Subcommittee will also continue to work to reduce drug prices by tackling the abuse of citizen petitions at the FDA. And all four of the bills we're marking up have some level of bipartisan support. First, we will consider my bill, H.R. 2339, the Reversing the Youth Tobacco Epidemic Act. Every year, cigarette smoking causes 480,000 deaths in the United States, and an additional 41,000 people die due to exposure to secondhand smoke. And while the U.S. has made progress in cutting down on youth tobacco use after passage of the Tobacco Control Act in 2009, in recent years, we've seen a dramatic uptick among young people due to the rapidly growing popularity of e-cigarettes. These products often carry flavors like mint, menthol, mango, and cotton candy to attract children and teens, and then hook them with extremely high doses of nicotine. As a result, youth tobacco use has reached epidemic proportions. In the last 3 years alone, e-cigarette use amongst high school students has more than doubled to 27% this year. If smoking continues at its current rate, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention estimates that 5.6 million American youth under the age of 18 today will die prematurely due to tobacco-related illness. And we simply can't allow this to happen. Congress must act now to avoid losing another generation to tobacco-related illnesses and premature death. H.R. 2339 adopts a comprehensive approach to ending this epidemic. The bill raises the minimum age to purchase tobacco to 21. It prohibits flavors and tobacco products, including mint and menthol, two of the most popular flavors among youth. It bans all non-face-to-face sales of tobacco products and protects kids from predatory marketing. Collectively, these actions will prevent millions of deaths and bring us closer to ending the public health scourge of tobacco once and for all. Now, the subcommittee will also move two bills to address the maternal mortality and morbidity problem. CDC estimates that about 700 women in the United States die each year from pregnancy-related complications, and thousands more face severe maternal morbidity. When you compare those statistics to other countries around the world, the U.S. ranks near the bottom. And the U.S. is the only country in the world with a rising maternal death rate. And it's really shocking and, I think, inexcusable. I'm hopeful, though, that through our bipartisan work, we can begin to counter these disturbing trends. The Maternal Health Quality Improvement Act, introduced by Representatives Engel and Bouchon, will authorize and improve a number of public health programs to address this crisis head-on. It incorporates provisions of Representatives Torres Small's Rural Moms Act to address health outcomes and access to care in rural areas. And it incorporates legislation from Representative Alma Adams to educate health professionals on how to prevent discrimination in care, including how to recognize and address implicit and explicit biases. These provisions are critical since African Americans and Native Americans in particular are 3 times more likely to die from pregnancy-related conditions than others. We'll also consider H.R. 4996, the Helping Medicaid Offer Maternal Services Act, or the Helping Moms Act. This bipartisan legislation, again, in this case led by Representatives Kelly and then Ranking Member Burgess, would allow states the option of extending Medicaid coverage to 12 months postpartum. And this would benefit a lot of families since Medicaid and CHIP pay for nearly 50% of all births. Babies born to mothers receiving Medicaid or CHIP are automatically eligible for coverage for the first years of their lives, but many women's eligibility ends 60 days after giving birth. And this disrupts care and creates gaps in coverage during the critical first year postpartum. This bill would help ensure that women are able to have uninterrupted coverage and access to care in the first 12 months postpartum, which is proven to improve health outcomes. And then finally, we're considering the Stop Games Act of 2019, again bipartisan, introduced by Representatives Levin and Rooney, that will help address the abuse of citizen petitions that delay or impede generic drugs from coming to market. This legislation enhances FDA's authority to swiftly dismiss anti-competitive petitions. The policy has bipartisan support in the Senate and from the Trump administration. It's just another step in this committee's work to remove barriers that prevent cheaper generic drugs from coming to market. Madam Chair, these are all important bills that will help us improve health outcomes and access to care, and I hope they'll all garner bipartisan support. And thank you again for considering them today. I yield back.